We are so delighted to have her here with us today to speak about female intelligence, women, and espionage. So let me stop sharing my screen so that Dr. Proctor will be able to share hers. Welcome, Dr. Proctor.
Thank you. Let me just do all the little clicking here to get this up. And all right, hold on a second. The Zoom controls were covering my controls from the for the screen here. There we go. All right, can somebody give me a thumbs up on chat or something if you can see this?
You are all ready to go, thank you.
Okay, great, excellent. Well, thanks so much, Cherie, and thanks to James Taub for organizing this. It's always a pleasure to speak at the World War I Museum. I have many happy memories of going to Liberty Memorial when I was a kid, going up in the tower and seeing the town. And it's nice to visit the museum whenever I come back to see family. Today, I want to talk about the secrecy concerning women's roles in the shaping of modern intelligence in Britain. So I'm going to be mostly talking about Britain and occupied Belgium today. Although there were women involved in intelligence organizations in all of the combatant countries to a greater or lesser degree. And I will talk a little bit about France and some of the general issues, but Britain's my focus. Most people, I think, consider MI5 and MI6, the British security organizations, as quintessentially male. I would like to suggest that from the very beginning, there was gendered work going on in intelligence and that women were involved really from the outset for lots of reasons, and I'll be talking about a few of those. One little disclaimer, this research is mostly from a book that I did close to 20 years ago now. So I'm not doing the newest cutting edge work on intelligence, but I do want to give a shout out to some of the newer books that are out on this topic. If you haven't seen Liza Mundy's book, Code Girls, which is about actually World War II women codebreakers in the United States, it's really fascinating. And there's a whole generation of new scholars in Britain who are doing work on espionage in World War I. So check those out. All right, let me move my slide here. This is a spy here on the front page. She probably doesn't look much like what you think a spy should look like. This is Gabrielle Dumanche, who was gathering information for British intelligence in Belgium during the First World War. And I'll come back to some of these stories in Belgium, but I like to start with this because I think she sort of breaks the stereotypes a bit. Just a little bit of background. Both men and women have been involved in gathering intelligence for the state in Britain, really, you know, since the early modern period. And there's lots of good evidence of this. But the real modern security state with permanent organizations doesn't start until the late 19th, early 20th centuries. And the security state we think of today really comes with World War I. And this is just a little timeline to give you an idea of how it emerged. Some of the earliest, what we would call, you know, counter-espionage or intelligence gathering, permanent organizations started with the police in the late 19th century. And then the Secret Service Bureau, which is the origin of MI5 and MI6, starts in 1909, so just before the war. MI5 and MI6, MI9, all of these, you know, these different intelligence organizations emerge around 1916. So in the middle of the war, they kind of organize them, name them, and divide up the work of gathering information. Some of the reason for the timing of this in Britain comes from the South African War. after the war, there was a sense that Britain was really ill prepared for information gathering. And so that's why you see these sort of secret service bureaus and a new Secrets Act that are created in that period. So in a sense, intelligence kind of reacts, I guess, to situations where states feel like they don't have the information that they need to proceed. So often around wartime. With the advent of total war and increased surveillance of populations, and I've mentioned one other thing here, which is the Aliens Act, starting to track people in the country, register their names and locations as part of the surveillance of populations, you see the idea that there's this internal threat that has to be monitored as well as the external threat in wartime. And so a lot of the women who are involved in intelligence are both in serving as monitors and part of the surveillance of the population at home, as well as people who are getting intelligence behind the lines abroad. So you've got both of these things going on at the same time. And I'm going to talk a little bit about both. And there's always this kind of fear of the enemy within that plays out in very gendered ways, which I'll also talk about a little bit. I think that part of the reason women were hired as human intelligence in the war zones is that they could move around with less suspicion than a lot of the men. And that's particularly true in the occupied zones in Belgium and northern France. So my kind of broader argument in the book and today is that without the use of cheaper female labor, the British government could not have created vast networks of intelligence and surveillance that tracked thousands of people with their daily activities, looking at domestic dissidents and suspected spies between 1914 and 1918. So I guess my big takeaway is that the modern system of intelligence gathering and counter-espionage was built on the labor of women just as much as it was on the labor of men, or maybe even more so in some cases. So gender also created kind of a lens for picking intelligence agents. And there were a lot of assumptions made about what men and women brought to espionage and where their loyalties lay. In recruiting leaders for the intelligence agencies, the Committee for Imperial Defense that did a lot of the recruiting early on looked for military men. Captain Vernon Kell and Commander Mansfield Smith Cummings were the two leaders of the early, what became MI5 and MI6. Both of them had standard military credentials. They had been officers, they had military education, one at Sandhurst, one at Dartmouth. And they had connections. They were from wealthy and well-connected families. So they were considered to be people with loyalty in a lot of different ways. British officials often considered men to be more patriotic and selflessly loyal, but also kind of vulnerable to female wiles. And so this is where women come in. They saw women as potentially excellent in intelligence, but also problematic. They, at this time, remember, were barred from voting in national elections, so they didn't have political power in that sense. They didn't serve as combat soldiers, so they couldn't be tested in terms of their patriotic activity in that way. And so they weren't necessarily obvious choices, at least for a lot of the men who were staffing these agencies. In addition, and this is important, a woman's nationality in British law was tied to her father or her husband. So a woman, no matter how highly born or well-educated or well-known, if she married somebody who was a foreigner, she lost her British nationality. And this is true until the mid-20th century, actually. It's a long period before women can actually own their own citizenship. You know, it's this notion that you don't have the right to vote, you don't have the right to your own nationality, and you can't really have loyalties to the state because your loyalties are always going to be to your family, were all stereotypes and legal frameworks that helped decide who got to be involved in espionage and who didn't. And I have a quote I'd like to read that kind of gives you a sense of how women were perceived. This is from a history of espionage in 1915. Quote, as a rule, women fail as Secret Service agents. In matters of love or revenge, where her deepest feelings are concerned, she is capable of a sustained effort calling for the application of whatever analytical power she may possess, but seldom in other cases. For an appeal to, say, her patriotism leaves her almost invariably cold and unenthusiastic, since love of country is a quality which depends too largely on an essentially platonic and impersonal principle to attract and hold for long her undivided interest and attention. So this notion that women really can't be patriotic, they can't concentrate long enough on their country for this sort of sustained interest, was a pretty prevalent stereotype among some of the early intelligence officers. So with these gendered notions of duty, loyalty, and emotional attachment firmly in place, intelligence officials decided to tie women to the state by exploiting their family loyalties and connections. So the idea was a woman might keep a state secret out of patriotic duty or love of husband or parents or children. And so they vetted women for the intelligence agencies through their male connections. So if you wanted to find women to work in MI5, you went to the men that they knew and asked them to kind of give you an idea of who they would recommend. And so the recruiting was very haphazard. It was through these familial networks. It tended to be mostly elite women in Britain, although it broadened out over the course of the war. And, you know, I'm not sure a lot of these stereotypes have disappeared. I think this is from James Bond, obviously. But you can see here, we could probably spend a whole hour just like analyzing this photo and from a record album and looking at the various kind of image that's being given here. But I will say that the notion that women are only really useful as femme fatales, as workers who get their intelligence behind closed doors, tends to really imbue a lot of the views of women and espionage in the First World War. So in terms of numbers, between the formation of the Permanent Secret Service Bureau in 1909 and the demobilization in 1919, it's hard to know exactly how many, but at least 6,000 women were involved in Britain or in areas of the continent behind enemy lines as civil or military members of the British intelligence community. And in terms of age range, it goes from 16-year-old girl guides to 80-year-old grandmothers in Belgium who are involved. And I actually got into this project because I was doing a history of Boy Scouts and girl guiding in Britain. And I ran across these references to girl guides serving at MI5 headquarters. And I thought, wow, can you imagine, you know, at the FBI or the CIA today hiring 14-year-old girls to work carrying messages at their headquarters? And the answer is no. And so I wanted to know, you know, where did this go? And I discovered that not just teenage girls, but women of all ages were involved in these networks and offices. So I want to talk just about three areas of women's work in intelligence during the First World War. And one is what I'll just call the Nameless Club. These are women working in the secret offices in Britain. The second are the soldiers in the field. There's the soldiers of intelligence working behind enemy lines. And then I want to talk a little bit about the images of the women spy that come out of World War I. So let me first talk about the Nameless Club. These are women who worked as clerks, as code breakers, as sometimes searchers at ports. They typically didn't leave Britain as part of their work. Although I've also included a couple of people here who worked in the Middle East for various British intelligence agencies as well. A lot of these women really never told their stories because they signed the Official Secrets Act and they took it seriously. And a lot of them worked for intelligence agencies, but never spoke about it. And never left any papers. So a lot of piecing together the story comes from the public records. This might be the least glamorous, but most important of intelligence work, and it's still the case today. It's the painstaking gathering of information, sorting it to make it usable, listening at the keyholes, I guess, as you think about it, and then getting the right information to the right people so that they can act on it. A lot of the women worked in London in the counter-espionage office, and they ran this massive registry, which was a card catalog of all the known espionage activity in Britain. Some of them had no previous clerical skills, so you know they were basically chosen because one of their male relatives said, "This person can keep a secret." And they had to learn how to type, they had to learn how to file, they had to learn how to do their work in the registry. I would say the paramount qualification for being employed in MI5 was being able to hold one's tongue. They wanted people who could keep secrets. Now, in addition to working in the registry, there were female supervisors. Women actually wrote the history of MI5, the internal history of MI5 during the war. So there were some historians. There were also chemists who did testing on secret ink. There were some working class women who were chauffeurs, cleaners, switchboard operators, lift operators, cooks, photographers, things like that. So there was some variety in terms of class background, but most of the women in the registry were educated and well off. At the height of the activity, there were two women superintendents and just an astonishing amount of information. They processed roughly 10,000 documents per month by hand. So you can imagine what the size of this registry must have looked like and how difficult it was to find information and why they were so skilled at it. Altogether, about 800 women worked at MI5 during the war, far more actually than men who were employed in the MI5 at the time. Now, I mentioned the Girl Guides. They actually were hired to carry messages. And it's kind of a funny story that MI5 first hired Boy Scouts, but decided they were too rowdy. And so they replaced them with Girl Guides. And so there was a company of Girl Guides, like a troop that was just assigned to MI5 headquarters. And they had drills on the roof and they carried messages. So kind of a fun way to think about the role of girls in the security state. In a few other places that I would consider to be part of the intelligence establishment in Britain, you have a lot of women working as well. Probably the biggest employer of women was the postal censorship. They were censoring all the mail into Britain, through Britain, and out of Britain. And because Britain was like a transfer point for mail in a lot of parts of Europe, they were reading mail from lots of different countries and censoring it. They hired women because a lot of women had language skills and they had university educations but didn't have jobs, or they had really excellent foreign travel backgrounds. And so they had, you know, skills at reading some of these letters. Altogether, again, about 3,500 women were employed by the postal censorship in Britain. And there were about 1,300 men at the same in the same period. So you can kind of get a sense of the division here. The last place in Britain that I want to mention is the emerging code breaking bureaus. So they were pretty rudimentary in World War I. A lot of the code breakers were mathematicians who were hired or naval personnel. And the code breakers worked, many of them were men, but they worked with women who again carried and organized the messages, decoded some messages, and helped crack the German wireless codes. This was a 24-hour organization, and so women worked in shifts along with men to help, you know, empty message tubes, decode the messages that they were gathering, and also to do secretarial work. So just to kind of sum up, in Britain, there was a lot of activity. It was all new. You know, they were building these organizations from scratch, and women helped shape the building of these organizations and the histories that were written about them after the war for the archives. Okay, and I've just shown you a few people here that went on to other careers. Gertrude Bell was an intelligence officer in the Middle East. She worked with T.E. Lawrence of Arabia, who a lot of you probably know. Very well-known figure there. Winifred Lamb went on after her work in Britain in intelligence to be a classics scholar. Hilda Matheson went on to work at the BBC. So, you know, these are very accomplished women in these organizations. Okay, I'd like to move to the area that in my book I call Soldiers Without Uniform. And that's from a quote from one of the Belgian women who was involved. Just to give you a little bit of background on occupied Belgium and Northern France, when the Germans invaded Belgium at the beginning of the war, they occupied most of the country. There was a small strip that the Belgian army held on the coast, but for the most part, the country was under German control. Parts of Northern France were also under German control. And this is the area that Britain and its allies wanted to get live human intelligence. They had a problem though. They needed to know whom they could trust in these areas, but also how to get the messages in and out. And there were a number of ways that they tried to do this. They tried tapping into some of the patriotic networks that were already in place. In particular, these escape networks that had popped up in Belgium to help Allied soldiers who were either trapped behind enemy lines or flyers, aviators who had crashed and were trying to get out of the country. They also tried to get Belgian young men out of Belgium so that they could serve in the Belgian army. And the two women here on the slide, in their prison garb. These were both members of one of the biggest of the escape networks early in the war that was tied to Edith Cavell. And I'll show you a picture of her in a second. Their job was to, again, help these soldiers go to a series of safe houses and then to get across the border into the Netherlands where it was neutral and then out of the country. Louise Tullier here on the right was a school teacher. And she was incensed when the Germans invaded Northern France and volunteered her time for this network. The Countess Jeanne de Belleville was an aristocrat who I think was in her 60s when she was involved. So these are people of all different ages. So at first, British intelligence tried to tap into these networks. They wanted, they figured these are already patriotic, connected, women and men, this would be a place where we could maybe try to smuggle some messages out. And so they try to kind of tag onto these networks. There were also people who immediately volunteered their time, like Gabrielle Petit, who was a young Belgian woman who was gathering information for the British from pretty early in the war. she was eventually captured and shot. So it was by the Germans. So she's an example of how dangerous a lot of this work was. And again, she was caught partly because of how she was smuggling the messages out that she was gathering. As I mentioned, Edith Cavell was the head of the escape, or not the head, but one of the prominent members of the escape network that was discovered by the Germans. And partly, again, they were discovered not necessarily because they were helping soldiers escape, because many of their members were gathering intelligence. And that's where the breakdown came and they were discovered. She also was executed for her role in this network. And this is the statue in London commemorating her sacrifice. And she became an important part of German propaganda or anti-German propaganda in the war. So that's how they started, was, you know, let's find networks that are already there and try to use those to help with what we want to do. Eventually, though, they established a bureau in the Netherlands and started actively recruiting people who wanted to help the Allied war effort. And they used family networks. So, you know, I mentioned early in my talk that family was considered to be an important way to tie women together through bonds of loyalty. And so they used whole families, their extended kin networks, their churches, their communities, to try to create kind of espionage rings, I guess, for the best way to think of it, or networks that would not give each other up, that would be loyal to each other, and that would be loyal to the task at hand. And they were quite successful at doing this. The network that I studied the most is called La Dame Blanche, the White Lady. And this was a network of about 1,000 people. Of those, about a third were women. So it's men and women involved in the network. And their job was to get information on the German occupying forces, the troop movements, the kinds of weapons that they had, information they could pick up in various places. And so they established a train watching network, and that's what this map is showing. And they, just to give you an example, a family living close to the train tracks might establish a window that was their window onto the tracks. They would watch the trains go by, they would count troops, they would count munitions, they would compile all this data in 24-hour, 7-day-a-week kind of watching. They put together reports that were then smuggled out of the country to the British to use in putting together a sense of what the Germans were doing and where. And as I said, a lot of times it would start with just one person who would then recruit all of her friends and family to the network. Now, in terms of getting the messages out, they tried a lot of things. They tried using wireless signals. They used pigeons, although that also created some problems when pigeons were captured. And eventually, they just tried to smuggle things over the border in the Netherlands, and that became one of the main ways to do so. The Germans in 1916 created an electrified border along the Belgian Netherlands boundary. And so women and men became what were known as passeurs. They would wear rubber suits and they would crawl under the electrified borders, the electrified fences in these rubber suits, through this kind of no man's land that was created on the border and into the other side. That was one way to get the messages across. They tried tossing them across to people on the other side who were also collaborating with the British. And sometimes they smuggled them across in their clothing, in items they were carrying in their cars. So, you know, lots of different ways to get the message out during this time period. Again, I want to emphasize that these were not femme fatale type women. They were women of all ages. And all backgrounds, everything from, you know, as I said, there was a woman who was a vegetable seller who was in her 80s who smuggled messages. There were two sisters who ran a bookshop, and they were the message box where people gathering intelligence could drop off their messages. There were school teachers, people who ran boarding houses. You know, you get the idea. There was a particularly important woman who was the daughter of a prison warden, so she was able to get information from those who were captured. The women used the fact that they were women to their advantage. They could visit each other and say, you know, we're just visiting our family members. Gossip was encouraged, and they passed intelligence in the kind of guise of gossip and rumor. And they kind of played on these women's roles, you know, oh, of course we're not involved in anything nefarious. We're just, you know, ordinary women. And the network itself, Le Don Blanc, recognized that women had an important role to play, not only in the active day-to-day intelligence gathering, but in the leadership. And so there was a male leadership structure, and then there was a female leadership structure. And the idea was that if the men were imprisoned or deported, the women could take over the network. So, you know, it's a really unusual setup, and they gave all of the members of the network military ranks as well. So they were really soldiers in these intelligence organizations. And there's some great documents in the Belgian archives of the women after the war talking about their rank and what they did. And they received war medals. You can see some of them here from the governments that they served. Okay, so many of the women got through the war unscathed. A lot of the La Dame Blanche members were never found out during the war. They survived and thrived in their intelligence gathering. But there were women who were either captured, or sometimes the neighbor would tip off the police and they would be questioned and then later imprisoned. All of the Belgian and Northern French women who were accused of espionage were put into the same prison, which is Siegburg prison. In Germany, which is near Cologne. This is a picture one of the women drew of their afternoon exercise. They also used some of the prisons in Belgium itself, in Lille, or in Northern France, in Lille, in Brussels, in Liège. But this was the main place to put the hardened criminal spies, basically. And I just want to emphasize that while most of them were recruited initially through these family networks, they talk about their service as if they are patriotic soldiers. They over and over again emphasize that they're doing this for their country, that they want to serve just like their brothers do. And they see it as a point of pride, both during the war and after. This is a quote from one of the teenagers who was involved. Her name was Marie-Thérèse Collard. She said, "At long last, that which I have so desired is realized. I am going to work for our nation and as a soldier." Another of these La Dame Blanche operatives said, "We've done our duty as good British soldiers, and with the assurance that our modest services will not be unnecessary to the great common cause." And it's kind of funny, she was actually captured and imprisoned. And when she was in prison, she got a coded message from the network telling her, "Remember, you're a soldier, remember your oath, stay silent, don't talk about any of the other members." Now, what was kind of interesting is in the British records, the British officials refused to really recognize this notion that the women are soldiers of the state. They keep referring to them in their familial obligations, and the women and the men both actually in Belgium have to fight for recognition after the war. And many of these families were ill from their time in prison. They lost family members to the war. And they made an argument that they were just as important to the war effort as the soldiers in the field. So that is just a little bit about the intelligence networks behind the lines, and I'm happy to talk about it in the Q&A if you have more questions. The last area I just want to talk about are the kind of perceptions of spies, and I'm going to focus mostly on Britain for this. I would say that there was this idea from the beginning that women's natures limited their ability to be good at intelligence. There was this idea that they were overly emotional, that they weren't reliable, that they could be swayed by love for a man. And this really is a thread that runs through a lot of the conversations about their work. And there was also a kind of, a spy panic that emerged in 1914. And these are a couple of kind of funny cartoons about this. You can see here the nurse is saying, "Goodness me, what have you been doing to your dolls?" And little Joan says, "Charlie's killed them. He said they were made in Germany, and how were we to know they weren't spies?" So, you know, this kind of jokiness that there are spies lurking everywhere. This is another cartoon from Punch, and you can see very much right at the beginning of the war, Ethel, the little girl here, in an apprehensive whisper, which easily reaches her German governess, to whom she's deeply attached, "Mother, shall we have to kill Fraulein?" And there were a number of these. These are just a couple of examples. That there was this idea that there might be German spies everywhere. So people started watching each other. They started reporting their neighbors to the police. There was a lot of anti-German bias in Britain, and actually attacks on German families and businesses. And the British state created a law called the Defense of the Realm Act, which is always known as DORA, D-O-R-A, or the Defense of the Realm. And that was the law that was used to prosecute spies in Britain. And in terms of the spies who were arrested in Britain and charged under the act, they were typically charged for trying to send messages to family abroad. A lot of them were foreign born, so they were already considered suspicious. It's hard to find very many women who were imprisoned within Britain for espionage activity who didn't have either a German background or or some other kind of foreign background that made them suspicious. A lot of times the women were not actually put in prison. They could talk their way out of it. They could actually use their status as women to their advantage, because they would say, "Oh, I was just lured into this situation by a man." And they would sometimes get off with a light sentence that way. One of the MI5 historians, the official historians, who was female, she kind of mocks the British male officials in her official history. She says, MI5 doubted there being a woman in the case. The woman was there the whole time. The case centers around the woman. And she, this historian kind of laughs that the whole time they're trying to explain away how this woman seems to be involved in the espionage case, because there aren't any men that are inspiring her. So it's kind of interesting to see the way gender works in this. But I wanted to mention that this plays out also in the public realm, and probably the most famous case is Maud Allan, who was a Canadian dancer who performed a play, or she performed kind of a dance routine to Oscar Wilde's Salome. And the performance was scheduled to be in London in 1918. You can see she's wearing exotic dress. And when the play was advertised, a politician and newspaper editor who was somebody who wanted publicity and who wanted to encourage this fear in Britain that there were enemies within and that women in particular could be part of the problem, started publicizing in very offensive terms, I guess, Maude Allen and her her play Salome. And because he attacked her so publicly, she and her publicity people decided that they needed to sue him, you know, for libel, that he was attacking them, that she needed to protect her reputation. And so they sued in the summer of 1918. Billing, the person who had instigated this, was a member of parliament. And as I said, he published his own newspaper. So he used his own newspapers for these attacks. And what was interesting about it is that he claimed that he had a secret blacklist of 47,000 traitors and spies living in Britain, and that they were in high positions. And Maude Allen is part of this group, but he's naming people who were actually related to well-known politicians in Britain. He's naming actors, he's naming, you know, just kind of with vague accusations, lots of people in Britain. And he claimed in his newspaper that the German leadership was using this list of known traitors and degenerates to recruit highly placed spies. So he kind of links together the notion of sexual deviance, being a traitor, and being a spy. And the Maude Allen case becomes the epitome of this problem. In describing Maude Allen, he claims that she's got an entry in his Black Book of Sin. And he also claims that she's a deviant. And in a quote from the article, he says, "In lesbian ecstasy, the most sacred secrets of state were betrayed. The sexual peculiarities of members of the peerage were used as leverage to open fruitful fields for espionage." So it's sex, it's treason, it's espionage, it's all of these things wrapped up into one piece. The article that really led her to sue for libel was one called The Cult of the Clitoris, which there are some actually funny reactions to that in the letters to the editor, people saying, what is that anyway? He claimed that, you know, she was the worst offender and that she was also a spy. In the court case, he continues the innuendo. And when asked to produce this blacklist of spies, he claims that he can't because it's a state secret and he can't do it. It was a national phenomenon. It was in all the newspapers. And in the end, basically the court sides with him. And they say that, you know, in time of war, he's not libelous. He's just pointing out where the possible problems might be in society. And so she loses the case. But this helps solidify the notion in the public eye that women are femme fatale, that they are Mata Hari type sexual predators. And I think if I were to ask most people today what they know about World War I spies, if they know anything, they probably know either Mata Hari or maybe, you know, some fictional James Bond type figure. They don't know about those women that I showed you in Belgium who were doing the hard work behind the lines. And you can see the comparison, I think. So here's Maude Allen, and here is Mata Hari as an exotic dancer before the war. And here's Mata Hari when she was actually arrested and tried for espionage. And I'd like to use this juxtaposition because in the newspapers when she was arrested, this is the picture that was used. When the National Espionage Intelligence Museum, the Spy Museum, opened in Washington, D.C. About 20 years ago, this was the entry photo or something very much like this to the exhibit on women spies. This is still the predominant image, I think, that we have. But this is the reality of Mata Hari's life at the time that she was arrested. And I can talk more about her in the Q&A if you want. But she's a person who had to make do for herself. She was divorced and escaped an abusive relationship. She was Dutch born, so she was neutral, but she lived in France. She was what was known as an international woman in that she moved around freely between countries as a performer. She was a courtesan that had relationships with a lot of well-placed military figures, which is also partly why she was suspect. But by 1916, 1917, she was also kind of down on her luck. She needed money. And the lure of promising together espionage really pulled her in. But this, as I said, is the picture of her upon her arrest. It's like her mugshot. She was in her 40s. She was not very good at gathering intelligence for either side. She promised to gather intelligence both for the French and the Germans. And she doesn't fit the image that the newspapers wanted to paint of this, you know, sexually deviant female spy that was destroying society from within. And so in many ways, I think the real women involved in intelligence are kind of lost from view. And it gets reinforced with a lot of the public personas that are painted of these women in the media after the war, whether it be propaganda posters or movies. You know, Greta Garbo here played Mata Hari with this fantastic hat. And unlike the real counterpart in the movie, she goes to the firing squad to spare her lover pain, sacrificing herself for a man, not for a nation. And I guess I'm arguing that the exploits and motivations of female intelligence clerks, field agents, and leaders remained hidden from view, both by the constraints of the Official Secrets Act, but also by post-war commemoration, where women's activities were shrouded by the rhetoric of familial duty and responsibility. A few women did continue to work in government intelligence departments, and they were hired in even greater numbers in the Second World War. Lots and lots of women were hired for various intelligence activities there. So the war not only witnessed the creation of modern intelligence and the entry of women into such work from the beginning, really in 1909 in Britain, but it also created some of the most powerful cultural images of the female spy in the same time period. Espionage defined as foreign and corrupting, it really fit uncomfortably with understandings of women's proper role in society, just as women's participation in war undermined the notion of real warfare. I think it was easier to see women as victims, as nurturing nurses, as sweethearts back home, or as spy prostitutes than it was to deal with the shift in gender roles that appeared to be taking place in wartime. So thank you, and I am happy to take questions. And I hope I did okay on time there.
Perfect on time, and thank you for a wonderful presentation, so much fascinating information here. And we do have some great questions. I just want to say that I cannot wait to go back through archives and find an article entitled Cult of the Clitoris. That is
yeah, one of the and that's 1918. 1918. Yeah, it's amazing, isn't it?
Hard that's fantastic. Yeah. I have a question about Mata Hari and this way that she is portrayed. As you talk about her execution and how it is portrayed in the film, I loved the phrasing that you use that she sacrifices herself for love instead of for a nation. And I think that's such beautiful phrasing. I have read that she refused a blindfold when executed, saying that she wanted to look her executioners in the eye. Is there truth to that story?
No, that's just a that's just a part of the myth, I think. There's not good evidence actually of what she did. There were women spies executed who refused blindfolds. But I'm not sure it's about looking the executioners in the eye. I think, you know, it's the firing squads are quite a ways away when they're actually doing that. But there were a lot of depictions of women being especially heroic in death. This happens with Edith Cavell too. And then depicting the men who were part of the firing squads as particularly murderous. So there were postcards, for instance, of Edith Cavell's death, suggesting that a German soldier in, you know, a little pointy helmet held a pistol to her head while she's on the ground. And this is, of course, not the case, but it does play up that notion that this is unnatural, right? These women should not be in this position.
We have some other questions here. Were there any American female spies and what would they have done?
Yes, there were. And I haven't really done all of the research on this. A lot of others have worked on it. But there were, so when the United States joined the war, they modeled a lot of their intelligence organizations on the ones already existing in France and Britain. So they used some of the same kind of formats, and they also shared a lot of information. So they, the American Army, also used local people for information. And it's hard to get records of them because a lot of times they paid them in cash or in goods. And that was more casual information gathering behind the lines, like in northern France. But there were some women, there were newspaper reporters who went to Europe, who then became involved in intelligence gathering. There were women clerks who worked in the intelligence agencies, both here and in Europe. And you could kind of see a similar kind of lineup of people in the United States working in intelligence bureaus. I would say for World War II in the US, it's even more pronounced. But there were women in cryptography, in surveillance, in censorship, in, you know, the early versions of the Secret Service here too.
Something that you spoke of early in the talk was the fact that a lot of times women would be recruited if they had the proper connections, being vetted through family, being vetted through those male reputations, mentioning that a lot of times it was because women had language skills and the like, but mm-hmm. not necessarily secretarial or office skills. Those would have to, they'd have to be trained for that. Were initial recruits usually then from upper middle class and above?
Yes. Yeah. In the offices, in the intelligence establishment within Britain. So, you know, for example, I think I showed a picture of Mae Wedderburn Cannon. She was the daughter of an academic, and he kind of played his connections to get her a position working in intelligence type organizations. In other cases, there are examples of women getting letters from like military officers that were associated with their families who said, oh yes, this is a lovely young lady and she'll be fabulous in this job. But this is also a period where a lot more women were going to university. And so they had the skills, but they didn't have the job opportunities. And this became a way to serve their countries as well as to work in something that was kind of interesting and where they could use their skills. So they recruited pretty heavily from the elite women's high schools that are equivalent of a high school, and also from the colleges. So, you know, write to a headmistress and say, who do you have some good girls that, you know, we could snap up as they graduate.
But absolutely never speak their mind or known for gossip ever. A question from Noel here asking if you can recommend any good books about the ALICE network. And I fear I am going to do damage with this last name, but I will give it a whirl. Louise de Bettigny?
De Bettigny, yeah. Okay. So I have a little bit about her in my book. Most of the good books about Louise de Bettigny are in French. So if you can read French, there's actually a biography of her. I'm not thinking of anything that's in English right now. I will say that there's a woman named Claire Hubbard Hull who lives in Britain now. She runs a Twitter account on women in intelligence, and she puts a lot of archival materials up on that Twitter account. So you might want to check out what she does. And she is right now writing a book on women in World War I that's going to include a lot more information. And I expect we'll have more stuff on Louise de Bettigny. So it might just be mean waiting for a couple more years till she gets that book out to check it out. But if you go and check out her Twitter account, she recommends books all the time. So if there's anything new in English, it'll be on there, I'm sure.
Wonderful. And could you tell us her name one more time?
Claire Hubbard Hull. And I might be able to put it into the chat. I'll look it up while we're chatting here.
That is wonderful. Thank you. Really appreciate that. That's wonderful mm-hmm. to know. And that exact thing that you're looking for, there's going to be new scholarship available about that. Another question that we have looks at those types of Mata Hari myths. Were there any legal attempts to prevent women from participating in espionage as a result of the attitudes and the myth that surrounds it at the end of the war?
Sorry, I'm just putting this into the... there you go.
Thank you.
Women know intel is what it is. So in Britain or elsewhere? Or is there any?
I think in general.
So were there ways that they were stopped from doing things? Is that the question
yes.
pretty much? Yes. Sometimes they were frustrated at their inability to move up within the organizations. And this is particularly true in MI5. There were a couple of women who were promoted to be superintendents, but they were still paid less than their male counterparts. And I think they felt sometimes that it was not about their capacity to do the work, but the fact that they were female and they were presumed not to have families to support. So therefore they were, the justification was, we don't need to pay you as much, which of course was a false thing for many of them. Women who were married were often blocked, and I didn't talk about this, but there was a marriage bar in the civil service in Britain, which required women to resign upon marriage in some kinds of civil service occupations. And so the number of women working in offices in Britain tended to be single. There were a few married women, again, with connections that got them into these roles, but married women could be frustrated by their inability to break into the jobs. And then I would just say that after the war, women were really upset that they couldn't get the recognition that they felt they deserved. And there is a really good book by Alison Fell called Female Veterans. I'm looking at my shelf. Can't remember the exact title, but I think it's Female Veterans of the First World War. And she looks at women who served in various capacities after the war. She looks at Louise Tullier as an example, who tried very hard to talk about what they did, to publicize it, to become authors, to get recognition, to get pensions, and none of that happens to the extent that they want it to. So I highly recommend the book, though, by Alison Fell. And there's one in Britain, or in the United States too, Alison Finkelstein's book, Forgotten Veterans, I think it's called, Forgotten Women, Forgotten Veterans. Does that sound right?
It sounds right.
Alison Finkelstein, anyway. So.
Well, we have time for just one more question. And I think this is a nice one to wrap up on. You've talked about some remarkable circumstances, remarkable women. If you had to choose just one spy from this era, one female spy from this era, do you have a favorite or a story that really stands out that we haven't already talked about?
That's a really good question. Well, I have several that are favorites. I mean, Louise de Bettigny's story is really great. I do kind of love her. I guess maybe the story I like best is a woman named Marie Berkel, who was a Belgian woman who was put into prison in Liège for her for gathering information. And while she was in prison, she smuggled messages out to the outside networks of stuff that she got from the other people who were being brought in for espionage. So she sort of ran a prison information network while she was in prison. And she had a collaborator that was a young man, Emile Fokinot, and the two of them, they would canvass the male and the female prisoners, and then they would gather the information and give it to another woman who was the daughter of the prison warden, who would then smuggle it out to the outside networks. I think she's really fascinating. And the two of them, Emile and Marie, actually married after the war. And there's correspondence between them about their activities. So you get kind of more of a personal look at some of the work that they did, because there are these personal documents and reports. So I like her.
Each story is just so fascinating. And I love the way that you've described today the reasons that women were willing to risk themselves to do this, and their concept of being patriotic soldiers, and how crushing it was for them to have these efforts diminished. And it just makes you want to dig in and take another look and read some more. And I do hope everyone today that's been with us is just as excited and intrigued as I have been, and we'll take a look at your book, which I did notice on is absolutely currently for sale on Amazon and easy to put in your basket and purchase. Thank you so very much, Dr. Proctor, for being with us today, for being so generous with your time and with your knowledge, and want to thank all of our guests for joining us to learn more about women in World War I, and hope that you will all take a look at our events page so that you can see about upcoming events, including additional Mrs. Wilson knitting circles that we will do in the future. Thank you so much, all, and we hope to see you again soon.
Thank you.